And I mean, this is a different talk than I'm used to giving in some ways, because I'm so excited to be here. I really would love, if you have any insights or just metaphors or anything that you think might be interesting things that we can pursue in our work, that's why I'm here. And I'd love to start collaborations, however you see that going. This is like the place in my mind to be for what I am doing and where I want to move next in my research. Right, so you've got all of this going on, models of complexity, collective thought and behavior. This is what I'm doing or trying to do and trying to move the field of neuroscience in this direction. This quote I love by Professor Savage, I think he's an external professor here, that with pushback from different fields, we can work together collectively and push forward new ideas. And that's, I want the pushback. I really, really, if you there have questions, if you think something doesn't make any sense, please push back. This is about us getting to a better place through this sort of dialectic interaction. Okay. Before I get started, this is my lab, or these are actually former students in my lab who are now at various stages of postdocs and assistant professors. I'm going to be talking about a couple of these people. Carolyn Parkinson's now a UCLA assistant professor. Bo just left to do a postdoc at Harvard. Most of the work I'll be focusing on is work that's being done by my current lab, including Adrian Wood, who's about to leave to go to UVA as a professor. Adam Bonks is a postdoc with me who will be here tomorrow. He was supposed to be here today, but his flight got canceled from Hungary yesterday. But he will be here late tonight and here with me the rest of the week. And Chris is my starting graduate student who is invested in these ideas as well. And we're looking also for postdocs who might be interested. So if you know people, please pass the word. This is with collaboration with my R01 co-PI, Uri Hassan in Princeton. So neuroscience traditionally has been this sort of brain in a jar model, right? We just kind of map out, we take one person at a time, and we put electrodes on them or stuff them in a supine tube, or we do a battery of tests, but always with individuals. And we've learned a lot about vision is, audition is, memory is, et cetera. But we don't know anything about how brains interact, which is arguably what we spend much of our time doing as social beings. And so neuroscience has been missing this core feature of human behavior. So by mapping out this, how an isolated brain works, we don't know anything really about how brains work collectively. And I first became interested in this question about a year and a half ago, when we ran a study looking at how brains are aligned to each other. And this was the question that we started with. We started with this question of whether we are friends with people of a similar mind. So this it may look familiar to some of you. It's now, you know, our birds of a feather flock together. This is from the 15th century. So this intuition that we collectively, we gravitate towards people who are similar to us has been around for a very long time. And we know in terms of social network analyses that people do cluster in terms of demographics. So they're by age, by gender, by ethnicity, et cetera. And when we get together, we tend to like mimic each other. We walk the same ways. We talk the same ways. We wear the same clothes. This is a picture of me. I'm annoyed. My husband's taking the picture. I'm just across the street from him in London. And I missed the light, and he's taking a picture. And so I've got that face. And then he shows me that I found my tribe, right? This is my little demographic cluster in London. But the deeper question is, do we cluster with people not just of a similar demographic category, but are we friends with people of a similar mind? And to answer that question, this is one of the best things about living very far away from you guys, in the middle of nowhere, which is Hanover, New Hampshire, if you've ever been. It's beautiful there. It's right, in the middle of rural New Hampshire, very few people. Saw a few people there. That's about it. This is Hanover, New Hampshire. This is where Dartmouth is. And up here, on the upper left, is the Tuck School of Business. And the Tuck School is fantastic because it's this like set of cloistered buildings So Hanover's isolated enough, but then you get Tuck. And in Tuck, people study together, they take all the same classes together, they move through their class structure together, all in these buildings. They eat within this set of buildings, and they live in this set of buildings. And so there's really no reason for them to leave. And they all just stay here for 2 years and get the MBA. And as part of their coursework, we investigate their social network structure. So it's like having the TV show Survivor, but imagine there's 256 people on the island, and we get to study them. And if you ask all these 256 people this one very simple question, you can construct their entire social network. So this is just tell us who your friends are. Consider the people with whom you like to spend your free time. Since you arrived at Dartmouth, who are the classmates you've been with most often for informal social activities, such as going out to lunch, dinner, and so on? Right? Basically, this is what we mean by friends. And then we give them a roster of all the people in their Tuck cohort, and we have them check off who this applies to. And because everybody has to do it as part of their coursework, we can construct their entire social network. So who's friends with whom, who's in the center of the network, who's sort of on the periphery, and so forth. And this was this cohort, and the orange dots are people that we took out of that and we did some studies with. All right. Now, one thing to note is that you can see if people are connected by like one path length. So here's two dots over here connected by one path length. And those people are friends. Okay, so each of those people said, this is checked off the other as a friend. So you can name these people Jane and Bob, and you can say they're friends. And then Kate and Jane are friends of friends. They have Bob in common, but they aren't directly friends. And there are also people who are friends of friends of friends and so forth in the network. Okay, and so we took these people of varying degrees of social connectedness, and we scanned them while they were watching video clips. And these video clips were selected to be previously unseen by the participants, to be engaging, which would minimize this uninformative sort of mind wandering, people zoning out, that sort of thing. But we're also differentiating. We didn't want to show people video clips where they would see it exactly the same way. We wanted them to be able to sort of express how they felt in terms of their brain activity. I'm going to show you what these movie clips kind of looked like. Keep in mind that they're much longer for the participants in the study, but I want to give you a sense of the breadth of video clips that we showed them.
When I was outside on my first spacewalk, I was on the dark side of the world, over the Indian Ocean. By having workers who only had to do one thing, they could pay them a low wage, and it was very easy to find someone to replace them.
The water squeezes out of the cloth, and then because of the surface tension of the water, it's insulting when a coach is making 5 to 10 to 15 times more than a college president.
These babies are not strong enough to cling, and they fall to the ground repeatedly.
At times like that, you don't often think of funny things to say, but I did. And I turned to the rescue workers and I said, talk about a rough day at work. That was referring to the spending the time up there being pretty rough. Talking about a rough day at work.
Okay. So there's sort of dry mockumentary style comedy. There's also slapstick. There are different music videos, political videos, all sorts of things. So having them watch all these things, and then we take the anatomy of their brain, and we basically just chop it into 80 different regions, anatomically defined, just a standard principled way of doing it. And then we very simply look to see whether these regions are doing the same thing across people's brains. So you've got two subjects, and I'm going to show you a green trace coming out of superior parietal and a purple trace coming out of superior temporal, and it doesn't matter what these areas are. And you'll see you've got a time series coming out of each of these regions while they're watching these videos. And you can do something very mathematically simple, which is just simply correlate the corresponding time series. So does this part of the brain, does this part of my brain do the same thing as part of your brain when we're watching the same stuff? And basically what we found is that for people who are friends of friends of friends, so it's 3 degrees removed in a network, they have relatively similar, widespread across the brain, relatively dissimilar brain activity to each other, relative to people who are one path length in, friends of friends. And friends are remarkably similar in terms of the patterns of their brain activity. Not everywhere, but huge swaths of brain activity are remarkably similar for friends compared to friends of friends, who in turn are more similar than friends of friends of friends. So in this study that came out in Nature Communications last year, we showed that when subjected to a common stimulus, such as these movie clips, friends have more similar neural responses than people who are further out in the network. Now,
can you say more about how you actually define correlation?
It's just intersubject correlation. It's just time-locked, moment-by-moment correlation of the two time series that are coming out of this part of my brain and that part of your brain, the same part of your brain. Well, this is streaming video, so it's not, there's not like an event where we can see a decay function. I mean, it's sort of all in there. Yeah. Or the decay from 3 seconds ago is similar in my brain to your brain, and on top of what we're processing at that moment, and so forth. A very crude mathematical approach. Yes? MBA students. Okay, hang on, just hang on for one slide. Let me speak to the weird question. So you're absolutely right about weird populations. I mean, you'd have to argue that friends of friends are fundamentally less weird in that way than friends in this population. And I think that's debatable. I mean, they're all sort of homogeneously, 40% are international. But you're right that they've self-selected into this immersive environment. There's something strange, potentially, about them. They're MBA students in rural New Hampshire. We don't know. But you'd have to argue that the pattern of results going from friends to friends of friends to friends of friends of friends somehow systematically maps onto something about weird populations. Like, why do you get the drop-off only in weird populations? But you're right, we haven't done this. We've actually done a number of studies in a tribal village in a very remote region of Cambodia where you had to use a machete to get to that village. And we did a bunch of perceptual behavioral tests out there and saw very similar responses, actually, than to our Dartmouth College students. So I understand the weird argument, but I actually think there's some hominid-level things going on, too. Okay, hang on, this is the next slide. We have a follow-up right now that we're running. So what you're identifying is that there are two non-mutually exclusive possibilities here. One is that we befriend people who are like-minded, and the other is that minds are shaped by those with whom we become friends, right? And I think probably both of those are going on. And what we're doing right now is we just took, in August, when they first arrived on campus, before they'd met each other, we took them basically off the bus, and we put them in the scanner, showing all the same video clips. And now we're in the process, in about a month, we've now waited, and we're going to see, can we use the brain activity when they didn't know each other to predict now their social network metrics? And furthermore, once we've done this, we're scanning them actually again to see what the additional slash other effects are of being in the same space. Yes? Yes. No, this is fMRI, so. Sure. These were all just one person at a time.
Yeah.
Absolutely. We get to a bit of a brick wall at the moment with the technology for getting a lot of people to be scanned at the same time, but I'm with you. Yes. Yes. That's right. That's right. They're all taking the same exact classes together. However, they're randomly assigned to study groups. So we're looking at that as being, and they're also randomly assigned, if they're not married, to roommates. So we're going to look at these things to see whether or not that is predicting the shared experience piece of aligning minds. Now, we know that this piece, the shared experience, has got to be at least in the mix at some point, because we're human beings that presumably you've had conversations with people in this room that have changed your mind and shaped you in various ways. So that's got to be in the mix. And this is a study that Bo ran, who's currently at Harvard, that tries to get at this question. We're not yet at interacting minds, but we're getting there. So in this study, the first session, you're lying in the scanner and you're watching these weird video clips where the sound's off, it's artsy, you don't know what's going on, and you're trying to figure stuff out. So that's the first session. Let me show you a little bit from a clip so you kind of get a sense of there are relationships, but you don't know what they are. Okay, you see these clips from different movies, and then you get together with a group of other people that have done the same exact thing, and you have to come up with a consensus interpretation of what was going on. Who was this kid? Was this a guy that was reincarnated into a kid's body but used to be the husband of that woman? That's actually the true interpretation. Nobody comes up with that one. They all come up with very different interpretations. And then in session three, they see those movie clips again, but now through the lens of the interpretation that they just came to as a group. And those clips are followed by novel movie clips from the same movies, actually. Novel clips from the same movies, but later on in the movie. So they have the same characters, but you haven't seen them before. And the question is whether or not the act of conversation in this consensus-building task synchronizes brain activity within the groups through this common lens, right? So that's result number one, is that yes, that's true. The way we did it, again, very simple intersubject correlation between pairs for all movies before and after conversation. And we just kind of made what we call change maps. How much did two people's brains come into alignment, come closer together in terms of the patterns than they were before? And the first result that we found is that the same group comes into alignment differently depending on what movie they're talking about. So this is one group that they're, and you don't need to know the brain area. I mean, I can tell you what all the brain areas are, but that's not what's important here. So look at the sort of general pattern. So light green means that these brain areas became more synchronous post-conversation than they were pre-conversation. And this is one movie, this is another movie, this is another movie, and just to note that the patterns in which they're coming into alignment differ spatially depending on the content that they're talking about, which makes sense to me as a neuroscientist. It isn't like there's a one region of the brain that's the alignment region. It matters what the interpretation is, how it directs your attention, et cetera. And you can take the same exact movie. Remember now, different groups are coming up with different interpretations of what's going on. And depending on the interpretation for the same exact movie, you get alignment in different places. So alignment happens, but it's context and content dependent. And you can take a cluster. This is just from the precentral sulcus, not important. And you can look at the time series of different people before conversation. So I'm going to lay over. This is each line is going to be a member of the group that had the conversation. Before they had the conversation, this is their time series for that clip of the movie. And this is what their time series looks like after conversation. And in every case, it comes tighter together. So they're seeing these new clips now through this same lens, and it's making them more synchronous. And this is true for the clips that they watched before, but also they're carrying that forward for new clips of the same characters. They're carrying forward the interpretation. These guys are brothers, and now I'm going to see it more similarly to people in my group. And you can quantify this by just very simply graphing the change in intersubject correlation from pre to post, and note when those peaks happen. And it turns out that these peaks happen in pivotal parts of the movie. So those two peaks at the end, for example, is when he slumps to the floor. So they're coming into alignment of the moments of the pivotal moments in the movie. You go from, well, I don't know what error bars would mean exactly in this scenario, but you go from about 0% basically correlated. In some parts of the movie, you go to like 0.2. In other parts, like there, you go to like 0.8 change in correlation. They go from basically not at all correlated to really correlated. But this is dependent on where you are in the movie. It's dependent for groups. But the basic top-level result is that you get increased synchrony after conversation. Yes, so that's a very important. No, that's not. So we're starting with consensus. So we have a follow-up. The next study is where you have to pull someone else. You have to persuade someone. There's conflict. You know, you're off in different starting points. This is about checking in with each other and coming to a common interpretation, a shared reality of the world, which is arguably one reason, but not every reason, that you have a conversation. And because we took these, the people that are having this conversation actually out of this tech network, we can look and see whether or not the centrality of their social network position predicts anything about how much of a sort of gravitational pull they have on people's brains in conversation. So, yes. Well, they're not in a court of law, we don't. You could, like we do pupil dilations, for example. Yeah. And you get people when they enjoy a conversation, when they're experiencing shared attention, you get correlated pupil dilations. So yes, you could do simpler physiological measures. You can also look at, like, we're even looking at how people use words and convergence and syntactical structures. Yes, and we are doing, so we have transcripts of the conversation. We could just do that. So and so you could get a sense of who has the pull on a conversation just simply by looking at, well, we know what the person's interpretation was before the conversation because we have that transcript data, and we have the conversation transcript, and we have people reporting what they believe to be the true interpretation after the conversation. So we can do it all with words. So yes. Do you need a $3 million machine? Yeah, yeah. No, but it... Potentially, it's still a little bit of a promissory note. What the brain, what's the added value above and beyond? Right, right. No, fair enough. And you're preaching to the choir. This is something, Yeah, I think there might be, but I can't. Well, this is actually just preamble for what I want to talk about. So, all right. Let me just skip over this because I really want to get over to where we're going next. All I'm going to say is if you take person, you measure their, I don't know who's doing social networks here, but if you take measures of their, how central they are in a network, how well-connected they are to well-connected others. So we had this, I'm going to skip over this, you measure centrality, you can get, these are participants, the larger the circle, the more central they are, more influential they are in their social network, and you can ask whether or not people who are more highly central in a network have a disproportionate pull on other people's brains. Our hypothesis, our intuition was yes, highly central people would have this disproportionate pull. So that's the question that we answered, and we got a little bit, not much, on this question. What we really got in a much stronger way was that high centrality predicts being pulled by others in the conversation more. I have a caveat to that, but that was a surprise, but we think that's interesting. So in summary of the conversation study really quickly, people's brains became more synchronized after conversation. That was content and context dependent. Highly central people seem to be more likely to adapt their neural patterns to others in the group, at least when the task is to build consensus. Keep in mind, this is a low stakes task. Who cares what you come up with for an interpretation? The task is to build consensus. You can imagine that a highly central person might see a situation like that and think, well, I'm just going to go with the best idea, right? I'm going to listen, actively listen, and come up with go with whoever has the best idea, build social capital that way. And when I'm in a different context, such as a conflict situation or a situation where I want to pull people to my own way of thinking, then I have the social capital from which to make that sort of pull. We don't know that that's true, but that's where we're thinking. The basic thing to note is conversation is essentially just neurofeedback, in the sense that conversation is about changing people's patterns, brain activity, right? We're coming into alignment with each other. We're trying to shift people's points of view. I think it's the ecological niche of language. It gives us all of these things. This is what conversation is about. This is why we do it all the time. What's hard for me as a neuroscientist is that while we know that's true, all of our studies look like this. They're one person in a cubicle. This is taken from a study I have under review right now. I do this kind of work. And it's so divorced of any kind of interaction because it's all about internal validity and mechanism and control. But we know what keeping people in isolation actually looks like long term, and it's not good, right? This is a quote from someone who's been in solitary confinement for 3 weeks. And he said, how do I explain to a person that just standing in an empty dark room hurts? It's like this mental, you get confused. I would wake up and not remember what I was. You know how you get that feeling when a word is on the tip of your tongue? Well, that happened to me, only it was like, what am I, right? He got into that kind of headspace in the absence of conversation. And I think that this is related to the survivor spouse death risk that, two people have been resonating together for 62 years and one dies and the other person is sort of resonating without a common structure, it's really problematic, right? So this idea that we form these kinds of coupled systems with each other, and that keeps us sane, not just that we enjoy conversation, but it keeps us actually, from going off the rails, and I think this is really important. The question is, how does it work? And this is where neuroscience just has no answers. And turning that into a question related to what I've been previously talking about, how does conversation create alignment? And I think the metaphor that I like best is this idea of mutual adaptation. So I'm sure you've seen a similar demonstration to this, but these are metronomes that are set at different points. And if you just put them on two cylinders so they can actually talk to each other, right? They can provide feedback to each other, then they do, and they come into alignment. And the question is whether that's a way to think about conversation, is this kind of feedback delivering device that allows us to micro-adapt moment by moment to keep the structures in the right place, keep the scaffolding in place. Yes? There's some information we have. Like, we do know what some of these brain regions are doing, or we think we know what some of these are doing. I'm going to say we think we know because I think there's a rush in neuroscience to call regions by names like the face region or the theory of mind region. And I think we just know so little about brains, and in particular circuits, that where there's just this sort of land grab rush is really sort of annoying. And I think that some of it is getting sort of rethought about. So, but that said, vision's here, right? There are some basic things. But what we're seeing with these, this sort of conversation task where people come into alignment, is they come into alignment in primary visual areas. Well, to some people, some neuroscientists, they'll be like, well, how does that make sense? Well, it makes sense because if your top-down interpretation changes about what's important in a movie, your attentional deployment changes. If your attentional deployment changes, then what you find visually important, your scan paths, all of it changes, right? So you're going to see alignment in visual areas all the way up to more, quote-unquote, high-level conceptual semantic areas. And we do know what some of these regions do and why. So why are we getting area 17 versus 22? But we, at least my lab, tries to stay a little bit loose at the level of, oh, this is exactly why we're getting 17 at this moment. This is exactly why we're getting 22 at this moment. We're just looking for patterned, general patterns, and looking right now whether or not we get more alignment or less alignment. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Right, and what is more predictive of future synchrony? Yes, yes, I totally agree with that. And actually, that reminds me a little bit of a question earlier that why not just look at the sort of the transcripts? Well, you could argue, I'm not super compelled by this, but you could argue that you can write anything down. You know, like, oh, sure, I believe the consensus opinion. Right, but when you show that primary visual areas are now in alignment with the other people in your group, even if you didn't say a word during the conversation and you just listened, I can show that your brain is now seeing the world in the same way. So I only have 10 minutes left. So I'm just gonna, there's a human study, there's a version of the metronome task that people come into alignment if they're allowed to give feedback to each other. But where my lab is going in the last 10 minutes is trying to take not just tapping tasks, but natural social behavior and start to try to grapple with the complexity of that data and try to understand how minds interact in a way that's a little bit more real. And the reason why we haven't been doing that as psychologists and neuroscientists is frankly because we haven't had the tools yet. So your significant other comes home, you say, how was your day? They start talking. If you're a social psychologist, you would stop them at this point, and you would go, if you wouldn't mind just filling out this survey, circling a number on the scale. You can imagine how annoying that would be to a significant other, and how much richness you would just be completely missing. But this is really what the state of the art is, or has been in our science. But now we're getting new methods, right? And I'm not going to talk to you about all of these, but we're doing a lot of natural language processing, modeling in the lab, pupillary dilations during conversation. I'm going to very briefly mention these two. This one, super briefly, just in case there's someone interested in computer vision that would like to talk to us. But I'm going to spend the next 8 minutes talking about hyperscanning. OK, cool. OK, great. And I am here all week, so if you have any questions. OK. Computer vision tracking, simply, I'm just starting this project where we took the talk population. They're meeting each other. This is orientation week for the first time. There's a big social event that we engineered so that we could flood the room with cameras and see how they interact with each other. So this is all sped up, and the colors are funky. But it's they do not know they're being watched. So there are cameras everywhere. And we have them also at low level. So what we can do is we can start to track them all. And we can identify them. And then the question is whether or not anything in their behavioral patterns, do they flit around like bees on flower patches? Do they stick and glom onto one person? Do they just stay at the bar? You know, does it, what predicts, if anything, how they connect to each other later on? And we'll do this again. They still don't know that they were ever filmed. We're waiting to once their social network stabilizes, do it again and see what's a better predictor of who's connected, not just friendship, but who are the social hubs, who are the bridges that bridge these otherwise holes in the network and these kinds of other social network metrics. No, we did it with consent. So Tuck has this blanket consent. As you walk in the door of the MBA program, you have to sign. You can opt out. Nobody does. To sign a release saying you may be filmed at any moment for research purposes. Now, after we do time two, we are, in fact, we are not obligated to do this, but out of ethical concerns like this, we are going to, at that point, explain exactly what happened, how we've dealt with the data, which will be de-identified. Once we know this person is this, we'll give them an identification number and throw away their name, right? Nonetheless, if somebody wants to opt out, we will scrub them from the video and take out their data. We haven't done that yet because we haven't done time two yet. So we're still a little bit in ethical limbo, but assuming I'm alive 3 months later or whatever, I will do this. Okay, but if anybody, it turns out that tracking human beings through space that are occluding each other, it's easy for our eyes to do it, but for some reason it's really difficult for a computer to do it, and so we're running into lots of problems. If someone's working on that in this room, please come talk to us. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, exactly, right. Let's talk about ethics. Social insects?
Yeah, they have.
Yeah. We're talking to some people who are working on social insects. That's what, that was Alan Chen, right? They painted mice with these rave hair dyes that glow under black light or whatever. We actually thought about doing something like that, like as they come into the room, they're like, we pat them on the head or something and stick something on. It's really challenging. Okay. So, but we didn't want any, like, even RFID badges. We just wanted them to not think they were being filmed at all. So now we're dealing with the aftermath of computer vision tracking. Hyperscanning. All right. So this is neuroscience in a level of hell. Like, I got my PhD in social psychology and then went to the NIH to learn neuroimaging. The idea of putting those together is like, I can't even imagine. I mean, the only thing worse than doing neuroscience of social behavior would be like, other than like sticking someone in a tube in the dark, would be like hanging them upside down and having them do it. Having them do it in the dark upside down might be worse than what we have to work with. So the question is, why even bother to try to do hyperscanning, which is just scanning two people simultaneously while they're interacting. Here's my why bother slide. Okay, so I want you guys to name the, I'm gonna give you an object, and I want you to name it as fast as you can. Ready? All right, good. So roughly, the fastest you can go is about 600 milliseconds. The reason why that's interesting to me is that gaps between turn taking and conversation are about a third of that. So this means that much of social interaction has to be negotiated as predictive codes in the brain. What people what? Ah, right, yes. Well, we should be able to see that. You know, we should be able to bring spouses in and be like, see, I knew you weren't listening to me. So negotiate as predictive codes, and the better the predictions, the greater the fluency. People are really hearing each other and connecting, they're dancing together. Before I die, I want to see two brains dancing together. That's my selfish wish for hyperscanning. A less selfish wish would be maybe convincing policymakers that solitary confinement actually does do physical harm. Turns out physical and mental, the divide is not clear, right? So this is what we did. We had two people lying in scanners, and we worked out all the details. So we took out motion artifact, noise-canceling headphones, noise-canceling microphones, and it's through an internet hookup. They're in different rooms. In fact, they're in different universities. Took us a long time to work this out. Yeah, custom made. It's actually quite comfortable, but it's custom made foam head case that just takes out the motion artifact. It's kind of amazing. It's it. Yeah, right. So the problem, the reason why nobody has been doing fMRI conversation studies is if you if the person's brain moves more than 2 millimeters, you're done. Your data is just garbage. So when we're moving our jaw, we're moving our head around. So it was thought that you couldn't do conversation in fMRI. But with these head cases, you can take it out to the level that it's better than doing just a visual task without this head case. So we solved that problem, and we've got a conversation environment. Now, we would like to do free-floating conversation. Turns out that's we deem that not to be very tractable, so we've got a conversation-like task, and this is it. The first person starts off creating a story. So they get a prompt, like a kid gets into trouble, and the first person starts talking. There's a kid, and he's on his way to school, and he sees a dog. It's a stray dog, and he really wants the dog, and so he puts the dog in his backpack. And then it's person number two, and they're like, but when he gets to school, he has to just figure out what to do with the dog in the backpack, so it hides it in the principal's office. And then the next person, the next person, the next person. You have to build like a yes and kind of improv game. This is what it sounds like. You'll still hear the scanner noise, but people can actually do the task even in that environment.
And they see where the spaceship just landed. They're really excited, but they're really nervous. They're kind of hiding behind some bushes. And suddenly the door opens.
And then it goes back, and you see they're building this story together, and they're creating this mental model, this shared mental model, this shared space, this sort of third room that never existed prior to the two of them getting together. So we've got this sort of interactive, building this mental representation together condition. We also have a non-interactive control in which they're each creating individual stories. I'm not going to get into that. But the idea here is that can we investigate this as kind of this coupled system? Is there a way to look at mutually adapting dynamics and the dependencies and across brain patterns? And this is my sincere hope and why I'm here, that there might be some insights that you guys might have. So some challenges that we thought of, or some sort of maybe things to think about, would be ideas about synergy. So this comes from the motor control literature. Which is how do you solve the degrees of freedom problem where you've got thousands of muscles and joints to control, and the idea is that you can functionally group these together into these sort of synergistic systems that stabilize performance in the face of perturbations. This has been applied to interactions such as dancing, and the idea being that movement control is better predicted or described on the pair level relative to the individual level. The intuition here, as you might intuit, is that a dialogue is synergistic. It's qualitatively different than some individual processes, or maybe it is. There's a goal that is sort of overarching that constrains the individual contributions, reducing the degrees of freedom in that we sort of self-regulate. We kind of agree what the bounds of the space is, and that it may be robust against perturbations. In other words, this two-brain system forms a synergy. The question is, how do we capture slash measure that? The other thing we thought about is conditionality. So we already know that semantic similarity, that if I think of a dog and you think of a dog, we're going to couple, we can measure that intersubject correlation of those patterns. But individual contributions are more interesting than repetition or just pure sort of time-locked alignment. My turn partially determines yours, yours determines mine, and that sort of thing. So the question is, could we hope to model such relations like that? And what's a realistic data set for that question? So I'm going to conclude by saying it's clear to me, and I think to everybody in this room, that we spend our lives moving from one interaction to the next, collectively sharing and creating information. And in so doing, we create these vast and fluid social networks. We don't know very little, at least on the neuroscience side, of how we do this, how we mutually adapt our thought patterns, how we create emergent patterns across brains, or why it's easier to create those patterns with some people more than others. Are we going to learn new things from examining this sort of real-time dynamical coupling, especially at the neuroscience level? Will these insights change how we think about thinking? That is a promissory note as yet. It's unclear. What's clear to me is that we spend our lives doing it, and that's sort of enough for me to be interested in the problem space. Right? This is how we are in the real world. Currently, this is the typical neuroscience experiment. I want to change that. Right? Under the assumption that evolution doesn't favor complex, metabolically expensive, ubiquitous behavioral patterns that are not advantageous, i.e. conversation, a complete account of human thought and behavior requires understanding why and how our minds work collectively. So I'm going to end there. Here's some possible questions for Q&A, but I'd love to hear what you guys have been thinking.